Today we're going to be using the iPhone 14 Pro with the viDoc RTK Rover. Using the viDoc RTK with the Pix4D Catch app provides iPhones with centimeter level accuracy by utilizing RTK corrections to all the scan data that is collected by the iPhone. And so using the viDoc and the iPhone, I want to survey this city center and create a high accuracy survey grade point cloud. Now several months ago, I surveyed this exact city center with a surveying total station. And I'm gonna be comparing that data set with the iPhone and the viDoc data set. This will provide us a good analysis of the data that we collect in comparison to the total station. All right, now I've loaded up the Pix4D Catch app, and as you can see in the live view, I can come up to the top left and connect my viDoc to my iPhone. I've input all of my NTRIP information for the Michigan Department of Transportation's CORS network. Everything looks good here, so I'll hit connect. And now the RTK is fixed, so any data I collect will receive RTK corrections. Now with the iPhone 14 Pro, we have an enhanced 48 megapixel camera for higher resolution image capture. And while we can't capture the full 48 megapixels, Pix4D Catch does have the ability to increase the level of resolution from a normal camera sensor. If I come down on the bottom right at the settings menu, we have some settings regarding how we're holding our phone and the angle at which we are capturing data. But if you come over to the advanced settings and you select resolution, you can see now we have a normal resolution, a 4K resolution, and a maximum resolution. So I'm going to select maximum resolution, which will provide us with the highest level of resolution for our imagery. I'll go ahead and hit done, and now we can start collecting data. Now I'm gonna be doing two separate scans here. The first one is along the curb of the road, and the second will be along the building. By taking both of these data sets and merging them together in Pix4D-matic, we'll be able to create a highly accurate 3D reconstruction using both photogrammetry and LiDAR. All right, I'm gonna start on this side of the building, and I'm gonna start to capture first the sidewalk, and then go around into the curb. And I'll start. And here we go, we are now collecting data. And as you see, this on the bottom is the LiDAR point cloud coming around the manhole, and I'm going to just turn and come around this side of the curb. We'll also get the mailboxes. Here we go, I'm gonna walk just along the curb here. I'm just gonna hug this curb here. Okay, and I see we have a fire hydrant right here, and I wanna capture as much detail this fire hydrant because I want to use it as a benchmark. So I'm gonna wrap myself around here just to get a complete 3D perspective of the fire hydrant. I'm gonna back up here, get more of the curb, and we'll continue to collect curb. It looks like there was an old light pole there that got knocked down. This is a catch basin and a tree. We're still maintaining RTK fix, which is good. Here we go, I'm just gonna keep walking along the curb here. The most important thing here is getting all the features that are along the curb, like the trees, these benches, and as well as getting the curb itself so I can get the elevations of it later. And we got some manholes here, so I'm going to get the manholes in this. Make sure I keep getting the curb though. There we go, I can grab this tree. We're almost done here with the curb, and I'm gonna come up here to just hug the side of the building. We'll end it there, and we will save the project. And if we look here, we can see a very nice 3D point cloud of the LiDAR sensor capturing the curb. We've got 933 images, so I can go through all of these images here, and we've got every little bit of the curb. Very nice, I like that. All right, now I wanna take a second scan around the buildings to capture the details of each of the buildings, getting building corners, downspots, and existing finished floor elevations. All right, our RTK is fixed. I'm gonna start right here, and let's start collecting data, and we'll just walk here just along the building, maintaining our fixed reading. As you can see, I've got the downspots, all the finished floors here. Looks like somebody got a package. I'm going to scan their package. Okay, we're nearing the end here. All right, and I'm going to do just a little bit of the sidewalk just to match with our last scan. All right, and now we can save our scan. And looking at the building scan, you can see we've got every single door, a nice amount of detail that we can work with, and we'll definitely be able to extract the finished floor elevations for all of these units. I really like how this point cloud looks. Let's take a look at the images real quick. Here we go, here are all the images, all 629 of them. Very, very nice. All right, now that we've finished collecting data with the iPhone 14 Pro with the viDoc RTK Rover, let's process all this data so we can take a look at the accuracy and see how it all turned out.
Hello and welcome. Now I brought in all of my data using the SanDisk Lightning to USB flash drive. If you'd like to purchase this flash drive from Amazon, check out the link in the description. You can also upload the data to Google Drive or iCloud and access it on your computer. So I've got both of my data sets right here. They're both zip files. And when I open up the files, I can see all of the imagery. And if I click on one of these images, for example, let's just say this one. We can see just the resolution is incredible. I mean, look at how much detail we have. And that just shows how much more detail Pix4D-Matic has to work with higher resolution imagery. Both of these projects come with their own respective LiDAR point cloud in a PLY format, and all of these data will be merged together to create one large data set. Now I've opened up Pix4D-Matic, and I'm gonna add both data sets into the software. I'll just drag and drop. So now it's gonna upload all of the imagery to this project.
Few moments later.
Okay, there we go. And it was able to identify the location of all the imagery. I'm gonna now identify the coordinate system. So I am going to be in Michigan South, NAD83, vertical coordinate system, NAVD88, and in geoid 18. Apply. Now, usually I always encourage everybody to use ground control points. Ground control points are the validation that you need to have accurate data. But because this is an experiment and I want to analyze the raw data that comes out of the ViDoc RTK, I'm not gonna add any ground control points. Instead, I'll be adding checkpoints after I've processed all the data. So I'm gonna come up to the top here to the processing options menu. And already I've got the Pix4D catch template loaded. And I'm gonna recommend you just stick to the recommended template from Pix4D. Gonna provide you with the most optimized settings for your output. So I'll just select calibrate, and I'm gonna leave this the way it is. And I'm also gonna select the depth point cloud, the dense point cloud. This will generate my photogrammetric point cloud from the imagery. I'll turn on the sky filter, why not? And then there's the depth and dense fuse, which will fuse both the LiDAR and the photogrammetry data sets together. I also like to process a mesh. It's just nice to look at. Sometimes clients enjoy looking at it. Everything looks good here, so I'm gonna start processing. And we'll be right back when everything is done.
346 minutes later.
All right, all of the data has been processed. Let's take a look at it and see how it turned out. As you can see, the green imagery over the blue imagery is calibrated location. So there's a slight shift as always to make everything calibrated and fit correctly. And now let's switch over to the 3D view and look at that. We have a nice point cloud. Now this is the fused point cloud with both photogrammetry and LiDAR. Let me show you what the photogrammetry point cloud looks like. As you can see, it looks pretty similar. There are a few holes and gaps, especially maybe around the trees. And this is what the LiDAR point cloud looks like. Now this point cloud looks a lot more scarce, but that's just because there's less points to work with because everything was directly measured from the LiDAR sensor. However, this point cloud is very useful because it'll give us data on points that we were unable to reconstruct using imagery. So fusing both of these point clouds together will give us the most optimal data set to work with. And that's where this fused point cloud comes into play. Things came out really, really nice. Everything came out crisp. You see the base of the mailbox really nicely. Corner of the building is very easily defined. You can literally see the bolts on the fire hydrant. How incredible is that? Some noise around the branches, but that's expected. The light pole came out very crisp and clean. A little bit of noise, but not too bad. And this right here is the mesh. As you can see, the mesh is always going to be a little funky on the outsides. But if we come to the curb here, we can see how clean this is. Very crisp and presentable. The fire hydrant has been reconstructed and it actually looks incredibly good. And while I may not use the mesh file to do any kind of data extraction, it's always just nice to look at. But I'm gonna go ahead and turn it off and stick to just the fused point cloud. Now to test the accuracy, I have reference data that I collected with a surveying total station. And I tried to take points along cracks and seams on the curb just so that it's a little easier to georeference the true positions. And I set these all to checkpoints as to not influence the raw data. And here we go, we have all of the checkpoints brought in. The total station points are the gray points and the georeferenced locations are the green points. I'm going to start by showing you the best points, the points that had the least amount of error, and then show you the worst points, the points that had the most amount of error. Starting things off on the south end of the project, we have this shot. It looks like it's a spot where concrete meets a curb. We've got about 7/100ths of a foot in error in the easting, right on in the northing, and about 7/100ths in the elevation. And for my metric users, that's about 2 centimeters in X, right on in Y, and about 2 centimeters in elevation. That's really, really good for some iPhone data that is being corrected with the ViDoc RTK rover. Another point I wanna show you is the existing finished floor of this unit. You can see where we shot in and where we georeferenced our checkpoint. We've got an error of about 1/10th in the easting, right on in the northing, and about 4/100ths in the elevation. So that is about 3.5 centimeters in X, again, right on in the northing, so right on in Y, but it's only about a centimeter in the elevation. However you think about it, we don't really care about the X and Y value. We mainly care about the elevation when it comes to existing finished floors of houses or of condo units like this one. So to be off about 4/10ths or 1 centimeter is not that bad. It's actually really impressive. Going down here to the north end of the project, we have this curb shot where the curb and the sidewalk and the brick all meet at the same time. And we've got some differences of about 5/100 in the easting, again, right on in the northing, and about 1.5/10 in the elevation. So that's again 1 to 1.5 centimeters in the X, right on in the Y, but it's about 5 centimeters in elevation. Now 5 centimeters is a little bit of error. I would say if you were to introduce some ground control points, maybe you can drop that down a little bit, but ultimately it's not horrible. And in many cases, that is pretty acceptable accuracies. Some of the more challenged areas, I would say back here in the north end, I got about 2/10 in X, 1/10 in Y, and about 1/15 in elevation, which is about 3 to 6 centimeters. Now there are certain points that I actually would prefer to use an iPhone with the ViDoc RTK rather than using a total station, because the total station just isn't as accurate at finding these points. One of these would be trees. It's very difficult to find the location of a tree, as you probably use offsets to estimate the location of the tree, which is not the most accurate method. Definitely not as accurate as measuring directly to the tree. Take, for example, this point right here. I've actually referenced where the tree is in comparison to what I have with the total station, which is in blue here. Our errors are about 4/10 in easting and northing and 2/10 in elevation. You're talking 6 to 12 centimeters of error. So I honestly wouldn't even call this error. I'd call this differences, because again, I think the total station is less accurate in this instance, and the iPhone is actually more accurate because it's giving a direct measurement to the tree. Another example of this would be the mailboxes. I kind of just held the mailboxes close and tilted my rod. I was quite a bit off here, and yet even the elevation is off because I tilted the rod. So again, the total station is not going to be as accurate with these points, which is why we have so much error in comparison to the iPhone with the ViDoc. Now, what about the benchmark elevation on the fire hydrant? How did that turn out? You can see here the error on the fire hydrant is easily identifiable in the imagery. We've got about 6/100 in easting, 1/15 in the northing, and only 3/100 in the elevation. 1 centimeter of error in the elevation for a benchmark is not bad. And that is the accuracy you can expect using the iPhone 14 Pro with the ViDoc RTK Rover. If you guys would like to learn more about this GNSS receiver, check out my link in the description and visit Pix4D's website. If you like learning more about surveying and geospatial technology, then be sure to subscribe to my YouTube channel, and I will see you guys next time.